pray at the end of you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. Good morning.
Good morning.
And welcome to our service today. The second of our two services. There are a couple of announcements I'd like to make before we begin. First of all, I'd like to welcome any visitors that we have today. Please make yourself known to me and others, and please join us at our coffee hour following the service. One announcement that I want to make is in the bulletin, but wanted to make note of it, is that the Presbyterian Women's Treasure Sale, which would have been scheduled for July, is going to be postponed and taken up in a new way in the coming next spring. So look for announcements about that. Are there any other announcements that you want to make before we begin? If not, then come and let us worship God. We stand for the concert called Worship. How very good and pleasant it is when kindred really together in unity. It is like the precious oil on the head, on the beard of Aaron. It is like the dew of Hermon. For there the Lord ordains his blessing.
Right forevermore.
We will sing verses 1 and 3. 1 and 3 of number 275.
Forgive us our injuries and our hardships and affliction,
Lead us to our hearts and that you alone will deliver us and our heavenly life. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Now here is the word of assurance that comes from God, and that is that in Jesus Christ our sins are totally and completely forgiven. Praise be to God. Hallelujah. Amen.
Amen.
So God gives us these things that we call brain or mind for a reason. We go to school for a long time. I don't know how many more years you're going to be going to school. Some of you will go longer than others may if you go to school after school. Because I went to school for 23 years. I don't know. Some of us are slow. And it took a long time. But you learn a lot of things in school, and you're able to remember some of them. You don't remember everything. I've forgotten a lot more than I remember of all that I've learned. But God wants us to continue to be open to this world and to other people, and we need our minds and our ears and our eyes to always be learning. You have a long way to go before you're going to be able to be out there in the world all by yourself. All by yourself. And responsible maybe for a family and things like that. So you still have some learning to do. But God will help you. God gives you this incredible capacity, ability to learn from everything you see and do in other people. From teachers and nature and all kinds of things. And we always want to be thankful to God for giving us these great gifts that we have. Can you stand up here, pray? Dear Lord, we thank you for these and for all of your children. We pray for all children everywhere, that they would know that they are loved and cared for. And we pray that they would continue to learn and grow and be able to always use the gifts of their mind and their memory to develop as they go through life. We ask your blessing upon these and all the children. Pray also for all of those who help us to learn as we are on our journey. And hear us as we pray together as Jesus taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory of God.
Thank you.
The scripture today, as you can see from the bulletin, is the story of David and Goliath. And it's the entire 17th chapter of 1 Corinthians. And it's too long, in my opinion, for me to read it to you and then say anything about it. So I'm going to read it as a part of the sermon and abbreviate. But before I get into it, I want to tell you a story. An archaeologist was digging in the Negev desert in Israel one time and came across a casket containing a mummy, a rather rare occurrence in Israel. After examining it, he called the curator of the museum in Jerusalem and said, "I just discovered a 3,000-year-old mummy of a man who died of a heart attack." The curator sort of sniffed at this, the boldness of this guy, to somehow assume he could tell how this man had died, much less exactly when. A week later, however, the amazed curator called the archaeologist and said, "You were right, both about the age and the cause of death. But tell me, how on earth did you know?" And he said, "It was easy. There was a piece of paper in his hand that said 10,000 shekels on Goliath." I'm going to read the story of David and Goliath. I know that you have heard before, but I'm going to read a Reader's Digest, a British version of it. Now the Philistines gathered their armies for battle. They stood on the mountain on one side, and Israel stood on the mountain on the other side, with a battle between them. And there came out from the camp of the Philistines a champion named Goliath, whose height was approximately 10.5 feet. He had a helmet of bronze on his head, and he was armed with a coat of mail. The weight of the coat was about 125 pounds. He had shin guards of bronze on his leg and a javelin of bronze, one between his shoulders. The shaft of his spear was like a weaver's beam, and his spear's head weighed 13 or 14 pounds. He stood and shouted to the ranks of Israel, "Why have you come out to draw up for battle? Choose a man for yourself and let him come down to me. And if he is able to fight with me and kill me, then we will be your servants. But if I prevail over him and kill him, then you will be our servants and serve us." When Saul and all of Israel heard these words of the Philistines, they were dismayed and greatly afraid. Now David was the youngest of, actually, 8 sons of Jesse. And the older sons, some of them were in Saul's army. And David was sent back and forth between caring for the sheep at home and taking supplies, food and things to his brothers. For 40 days, the Philistine came forward and took his stand, morning and evening. When David got to Saul's camp, he left his things in charge of the keeper of the baggage. He ran into the ranks, and he went and greeted his brothers. As he talked with them, Goliath came out of the ranks of the Philistines and spoke the same words as he had before. And David heard them. All the Israelites, when they saw the man, fled from him and were very much afraid. David said to the men who stood by him, "Who is this uncircumcised Philistine that he should defy the armies of the living God?" When the words that David spoke were heard, they repeated them before Saul. And Saul sent for him. David said to Saul, "Let no one's heart fail because of him. Your servant will go and fight with this Philistine." Saul said to David, "You are not able to go against the Philistine to fight with him, For you are just a boy, and he has been a warrior from his youth. But David said to Saul, your servant used to keep sheep for his father, and whenever a lion or a bear came, he took a lamb from the flock. I went after it and struck it down, rescuing the lamb from its mouth. And if it turned against me, I would catch it by the jaw, strike it down, and kill it. Your servant has killed both lions and bears, and this uncircumcised Philistine shall be like one of them, since he has defied the armies of the living God. David said, the Lord, who saved me from the paw of a lion and from the paw of a bear, will save me from the hand of this Philistine. So Saul said to David, go, and may the Lord be with you. Saul clothed David with his own armor, and David tried in vain to walk, for he was not used to it. Then David said to Saul, I cannot walk with thee, for I am not used to it. So David removed them. Then he took his staff in his hand, and chose five smooth stones from the wadi, and put them in his shepherd's bag in the pouch. His sling was in his hand, and he drew near to the Philistine. The Philistine came and said to David, am I a dog that you come to me with sticks? And the Philistine cursed David by his gods. The Philistine said to David, come to me, and I will give your flesh to the birds of the air and to the wild animals of the field. But David said to the Philistine, you come to me with sword and spear and javelin, but I come to you in the name of the Lord of hosts, the God of the armies of Israel, whom you have defied. This very day, the Lord will deliver you into my hand, and I will strike you down and cut off your head, so that all the earth may know that there is a God in Israel. And that all this assembly may know that the Lord does not save by sword and spear, but the battle is the Lord's, and he will give you into our hand. When the Philistine drew nearer to meet David, David ran quickly toward the battle line to meet the Philistine. David put his hand in his bag, took out a stone, slung it, and struck the Philistine on the forehead. The stone sank into his forehead, and he fell face down on the ground. So David prevailed over the Philistine with a sling and a stone, striking down the Philistine and killing him. There was no sword in David's hand. Then David ran and stood over the Philistine. He grasped his sword, drew it out of its sheath, and killed him. And then he cut off his head with it. May the Lord bless to us the reading and hearing of his holy word. Now, it's really a bit anticlimactic at the end. Does it make sense? I mean, the build-up is great, but when it gets towards the end, the battle between David and Goliath itself is all over before it even begins. It's definitely not Rocky or Raiders of the Lost Ark. And all the really great action movies, the hero is captured by the villain, isn't he? And toyed with, played with for a while. Remember the James Bond movie? There's none of that in this story. Goliath is still laughing, for heaven's sake. He still thinks it's all a joke. Remember all that build-up about his heavy armor and powerful weapons? They never even come into play. He doesn't so much as draw his sword. No sooner did he take a step towards David than it's all over. One little stone struck him in the only spot that he had unprotected by his armor. Now, how did that song go? One little word shall tell him. Don't get me wrong. It's still a great story. But what does it mean? from a historical and literary perspective, of course, is part of a much larger story of Israel's history, especially the part about Samuel and Saul, and eventually David and King Solomon. But the church has never been interested, ultimately, in biblical stories simply for their literal historical aspects. For a story to have real meaning, it needs to convey truth about life, about human experience. If what it has to teach is true about human experience, then it's true not only for the Israelites and for the early church that chose to include it in the canon, but also true for you and for me. So what is this story about? Well, let's begin by asking ourselves whether Goliath is represented as represented by the teller of this story is part of human experience. Is Goliath part of your experience? He's larger than life. He's stronger than you are by far. Menacing, threatening. He stands right there in front of you and holds you in fear, terror, keeps you from living, from being happy and free, keeps you from being who you are and doing what you're called to do. From time to time, you may entertain, like the Israelite soldiers did, the notion of taking on this giant, but you don't have the courage to even really try to. Goliath makes you small, takes away your dignity. In the face of Goliath, as it was with Saul's army, you don't even mention God in the city. God doesn't seem relevant to the situation, which poses real danger. Think about alcoholism and drug addiction for a moment. Could this be Goliath in your life, or in the life of someone you know? Chances are, armed with the best of intentions and willpower, you or they will lose the battle. There's probably no reason to even begin to fight. However, these are not Goliath for everyone, either. But in my life and in your life, in everybody's life, there are things that we fear, that we're afraid to face. There are giants who are hostile to us and all that we hold dear. There are storms that threaten to overwhelm us. For each of us, the dangers are different, of course. The things that we fear vary from person to person, and the intensity of our fear, likewise, varies. I know people who are afraid of heights, people who are afraid to drive in city traffic, others who dread speaking in public, and still others terrified of getting cancer or Alzheimer's. Some people fear being alone. Some are frightened of their own sense of inadequacy. Others worry and fret about becoming unemployed or not being able to pay their bills, or having to face an abusive spouse. Some struggle with fear that a secret they hold about themselves might be discovered, perhaps an obsession with food, or pornography, or sex, or an affair they're having. Some are so terrified of their own emotions that they don't allow themselves to even feel them, much less express them, or share them with their loved ones. There are all kinds of dangers that we face. Some are out there in the world around us, and some are aspects of our own self that we carry within us and fear. The only Israelite willing to face Goliath head on is David. Who would you have put your shackles on? David or Goliath? Here is David, untrained for battle, younger than virtually all the Israelite soldiers, including the his own brother. Too small and weak to wear King Saul's armor or even lift his sword. And yet he alone has the courage to volunteer to single-handedly face the monster. You know the story. David does slay Goliath. He doesn't do it with weapons of war, however, but with something he was familiar with as a shepherd, a slingshot, something that was part of who he was and with his awareness of God. So you tell me, what's the story about? Is it about a fearsome giant and an ensuing battle between two individuals over 3,000 years ago in a little country in the Middle East called Israel? Well, yes, historically you could say that. But you could also say that it's a story about fear, courage, and faith, and the dynamics that take place within each and every one of us on a daily basis. I look out among you today, and what do I see? Do I see a whole lot of Goliaths out there? No. I'm not sure I see any. Do I see members of the Israelite army cowering in the face of that who is challenging them at this time in their lives, afraid to step out and face it? I hope not, but that's what I too often see when I look in the mirror. Or do I see David, one who is utterly vulnerable and totally unprepared according to all the wisdom and understanding of our society and the world around us, and yet one who is aware of God's presence and strength within himself? The Israelites, when they saw Goliath, and the disciples, when they saw the wind and the wave, felt powerless, overwhelmed, and unable to help themselves, and they were afraid. Both David and Jesus knew from where their strength came. They knew who was in charge. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. Or from Psalm 27, the Lord is my life and my salvation. Whom shall I fear? The Lord is the stronghold of my life. Of whom shall I be afraid? Or from Isaiah 43, do not fear, for I have redeemed you. I have called you by name, and you are mine. When you pass through the waters, I will be with you, and through the rivers, they shall not overwhelm you. When you grow afraid, when you doubt that you'll be able to take another step, when you feel that you'll surely perish, remember the story of David and Goliath, and remember that you are David. You are David, God's chosen and beloved. And yet Christ himself abides in you, and you in him. We are well off in God. God's holiness, all on you. The second hymn during our summer month is a choice. I see Eric's hand.
442.
Let me see if I like it, Eric. Number 442. That's as I am. Okay. Thank you. Good one. And we come now to our time of prayer together, and there's a few names that I would like to mention. First of all, I'd like to welcome Mark Beckwith back with us in the sanctuary. We're delighted to continue to recover. Also, Diane Perry, who we knew was in the hospital the last couple of weeks but for surgery, but she's home from the hospital. She thought she would be here today, but then this morning she called and said she was not going to be able to be here today. Delighted to see Bob Long here with us today. He's been on our hearts and minds the last few weeks as well. Lorraine Cheekman, Sarah Bass' mother, is in Stony Brook Hospital still, and she's undergoing treatments for her cancer. And Betty Donahue, I know some of you are friends of Betty. She's been home taking care of her husband, and she's still home, still taking care of her husband, but she's recently been diagnosed with late stage and very severe form of cancer. So we want to remember her and hold her in our prayers as well. Are there any others that you'd like to lift up in our time of prayer? In the bulletin, Lynn Jones's mother-in-law, Elaine Jones, is mentioned. We want to remember their family in prayer as well. They've been Elaine's walk to service for Elaine yesterday. And let us bring our hearts and minds together in prayer. Lord of life and light and love, hear the prayers of this congregation and of each and every person who is part of it in any way, and each one who is here this morning, whether or not they are numbered. You have given this church much, and as Jesus reminds us, from those to whom much has been given, much will be required. Lord, we pray for our nation at this time, a nation divided and obsessed with politics. So much attention has been focused on the U.S.-Mexican border in recent months, and it's difficult to explain it, except as a result of politics. But suddenly we're being told that Latin American immigrants are a threat to our national security, and yet we know that has never been true. Our immigrant population has never taken jobs away from native-born Americans, but has only strengthened our economy through the years, providing labor for jobs none in this room would ever take. We're being told that these immigrants, most of whom are fleeing torture and rape and violence in their own countries, are criminals. And yet this also, we know, is not the truth. The crime rate among immigrants is a fraction of that among native-born Americans, and seeking asylum is not a crime, but a human right, recognized by virtually every nation in the world. So it's difficult, Lord, to understand why these immigrants seeking asylum are suddenly being treated so severely, even separating children from their parents with no documentation. We pray for our nation, O God. We pray for the children who have recently been transported to the state of New York. We pray for their families. We pray for those who are responsible for these practices. And we pray that they will amend these practices and turn their attention to the issues that are real threats to our nation's well-being, such as adequate health care, education, poverty, and caring for our environment. On this graduation weekend, we pray for all of those who have just taken the next step in their journey toward adulthood, for those who graduated from our own church's preschool on Friday, as well as all those who have graduated from high school and colleges this spring. Especially, we pray for Griffin Wagner, that you will give him the strength and wisdom he needs as he seeks this next phase of this journey. We pray for those in our church who are seeking higher education, and especially those whose names are in our church bulletin this morning because they are benefiting from scholarships from our church, which gives us a way of participating in their education. Lord, help all of us to become instruments of your love and your peace, and even of your joy everywhere we go, never failing to help those in need while offering a cheerful smile where there is sadness. We pray for all of those on our prayer list, for those whom we've lifted up here this morning by name, and we pray for ourselves. In all of this, we pray in the name of your Son, our Lord, Jesus Christ. Amen. At this time, I would invite students to come up for the minute permission. I think you've all agreed with me that our children are our most valuable resource in this church. We raise them from infants. They learn the Bible stories. They pick up our morals. They become wonderful adults, and on they go. But don't you find graduation time just a little scary? Because what's going to happen next to them? Will they stick with us and with our church backgrounds, or do they fly off, and who knows what becomes of them? We recognize people like Griffin Wagner. Doesn't seem like just a few years ago that Griffin was born, and we've watched him grow up. I watched him with great pride to become an Eagle Scout in scouting, and to say, yes, that's what we want. And by the way, the pastor nominating committee is trying very hard to find a minister who will bring children to our mass and continue on what we're doing. We try. We're still working on that. Our graduates and some of our students who are off in college benefit from Memorial Scholarship Fund, and one of the things that we've asked them to do is to describe their service activities, and we got some nice letters back that I'd like to read to you. By the way, Taylor Wagner, Griffin's sister, has just graduated from RIT with a degree in fine arts. Griffin is our only graduating senior and first-time recipient. He has served our church as a youth deacon and youth trustee and participated in REACH work camps. He's an Eagle Scout, which is in itself a huge accomplishment. And in that capacity, he designed and built a sandbox here in our playground, which our little ones enjoy daily. Thank you, Griffin, and good luck in your college adventures. Emily Black, who also participated in youth group service projects, has taken her dedication to service in college and worked as a volunteer in the Ontario County Youth Court, providing restorative programs to young offenders. Keaton Campbell taught in our Children's Summer Program, our vacation Bible school, and serves as a youth elder. He works hard each year to transform our fellowship hall into a themed space for vacation Bible school. Madeline Campbell taught in our summer programs as well during the year in Tubby School. At college, she serves her community actively through fundraising projects. Madeline is running our summer Bible school again this year, and we appreciate that tremendously. Andrew Hempelthang in our choir participated in all of our youth service projects, Heifer International, Maureen Taven, food drives, REACH programs, and more. And he was kind enough to write that he loves and misses us. Daniel Claw has been tutoring and mentoring in an orphanage in South Africa. He credits the values and morality that he learned from our church for the impact he's been able to make on the children in his charge. And Leland Claw reports that his time in our choir and his work for our various community service activities continues to have a huge impact on his life. He too feels that he carries our church with him into his college experience. Isn't that great? We're doing well. I look around this church today, and I recognize a whole generation of people who grew up here and have come back and served us as well. Janet Hahn, Pat Schultz, Chris Haddad, Lynn Jones, Tracy Zolway, Kathy Holliday, and I look all the way in the back, and I think I see Jennifer Tresca from about four ministries ago. So indeed, we raise up our children, and they come back and join us. Let us give our gift.
Amen. Thank you.